Sam Rubin, ladies and gentlemen.
I live in this moment right now with you, Sam.
Oh. You're nice, Sam. See?
This is how I'm meant to live.
Could I do backup for you guys?
I think you got a little work to do, bro.
I love Sam Rubin so much.
Sam's the greatest.
Sam is the most talented entertainment reporter and anchor I've ever met.
I've kind of always wanted to do this. So when I first got on the morning news, I was like, I can't believe I'm sitting here, and I hope I can sit here for a long time.
Kermit, what I thought was very magnanimous of you.
But I certainly like using the word magnanimous.
Yes.
You know, it's such a big word.
Magnanimous.
Magnanimous.
Look at you. You think you're somebody with your little glasses. I see you.
Don't you like
you
it?
You think you're sexy.
No, I haven't.
I'll say this isn't without vanity, but it probably is. I thought, oh my gosh, you know, everybody's going to watch. Everybody's going to see me. And maybe 2 weeks in, I realized nobody's watching. My mother would watch for 1 hour a day. And her great review was, you know, 1 hour a day, it's all I can take. You know, I figured this was not going well. And they brought a new executive producer in, a guy named Joel Tater. You're all gonna get fired anyway, so you should just do whatever you want.
Sam, you forgot your microphone again. How appropriate.
And we were just
And that was the most important lesson.
I'm very nervous. We're gonna try to get in to the Channel 2 newsroom.
The very first
yes,
Sam
you.
Mug.
We do not put on these ridiculous shorts and run around for our health.
You know, and this was a slow build, but it became increasingly clear that the people, you know, we cover as an entertainment reporter watch the show.
Hi, family.
Hi. Nice to see you, family.
It's in our bed every morning.
My grandmother's here. She loves you. You have given me brownie points for the rest of my life.
KTLA. Best entertainment coverage. On the red carpet, KTLA.
Very good.
Wow.
Let go, Sam.
Think about over the years how many people have come into KTLA because of Sam, to be interviewed by Sam.
Enjoy the day. Thanks so much. Good to see you. Thank you.
Taylor Swift playing her Taylor.
Just a boy in a Chevy truck.
I think one of Sam's greatest strengths is Sam has a way of talking to people without them really even knowing he's talking to them.
Is it shampoo and conditioner or just shampoo? What is the hair regimen, Jared? Good morning to you.
Well, you know, my friend, it's a toupee.
Sam's the man. He's a brilliant guy and he deserves every accolade that he receives.
Our 6 a.m. show is 100% better because of Sam Rubin.
I do the 6 a.m. news as a personal favor
right.
to Megan and Chris.
Right.
I'm not even supposed to be on it.
For having done this job for 30 years, he is like a kid in a candy store when it comes to his job. He loves what he does. He loves Hollywood. He loves the movies. He loves when celebrities know his name, and they do. They all know Sam, and that's the truth.
Can we come to the wedding? When you spend those 3 or 4 nights a week with Rashid, with Common, how often do you think of me and give me credit for the initial introduction? Proceed.
Well, I give you credit every morning I wake up, and I'm like, yeah, this is all Sam's fault.
Wow. That is ridiculous.
Who are you talking to? I'm talking to Lorraine.
Yes.
There we go.
You all just right. hang up on her without
saying
goodbye.
Sorry, no, I didn't.
We're the Crack Entertainment Department.
We're Sam's glorified babysitters.
Making fun of Sam is the only reason we still work here. I mean, it's what brings us here every day, keeps us coming back.
Was all written in the script. All you had to do was read it.
But
how hard is it to read the freaking script?
We make so much fun of him, and he's so self-deprecating.
I really don't know how you made it this far.
He's gonna teach you some days. We heard that you're the best sender.
It's been the profound joy of my professional life.
At the end of the day, he is the best person to work for, like the nicest soul.
We are blessed and lucky when we're not being thrown under the bus.
Let's spell it out. S-A-M-R-U-B-I-N. Sam Rubin, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
A tremendous loss for our KTLA family. Sam Rubin has died. Sam was a staple here at KTLA for decades and a treasured member of the Southern California community. Good evening, I'm Samantha Cortese.
And I'm Rick Chambers. We're continuing our coverage, remembering Sam Rubin. We tossed the word icon around a lot in this time, but he was definitely that. He joined the KTLA Morning Show in 91. He was a legend in the entertainment community and hosted countless red carpets.
People have been calling in throughout the day offering their condolences, and KTLA's Corinne Winter has more on Sam's passing and legacy.
Always very exciting, Channel 5, the flagship affiliate.
His infectious smile.
Here in Hollywood, I'm Sam Rubin.
Spirited laughter.
Because we've been doing this for a long time.
And high energy.
Forget all these awards.
For decades, since 1991, audiences all across the Southland woke up to this familiar face.
And that 2011 has featured a slew of bad movies.
Sam Rubin. He was a staple on the KTLA Morning News, but for viewers, he was much more.
So much more from the Critics' Choice Awards. An important award is for Best Foreign Language Film. The 91st Academy Awards.
As a fixture in Hollywood, you'd often catch him schmoozing with celebs on the red carpet or chatting it up with stars on set. Sam's welcoming demeanor made everyone feel comfortable. It really was like talking to a friend. The TV veteran didn't just deliver stories and conduct interviews. He captivated viewers with a signature style that made him an industry legend.
Most fans first became familiar with Penny Marshall.
From award shows.
Critics' Choice Awards were here at Barker Hangar.
To reporting on blockbuster news involving celebrities. Sam covered the entertainment industry like no other journalist here in Los Angeles.
Tomorrow on the KTLA Morning News, much more from the Golden Globes.
He was experienced. He was trusted and so beloved.
Sunday night here in Beverly Hills.
Sam launched his own production company, SRE Inc., which produced hundreds of hours of broadcast and cable programming. He received numerous awards over his lengthy career, including a Lifetime Achievement Award from the Southern California Broadcasters Association. Sam also had a passion off-air, something dear to his heart. The MS-150 Beta Bike Tour, which helped literacy programs and supported L.A. schools.
And awesome. Among the nice things about working here for a little bit is your kids, of course.
Perhaps Sam's biggest love, his family, who he always beamed about. His wife, Leslie, and their children, Colby and Darcy, and former wife, Julie, and their daughters, Perry and Rory. Sam lived and worked here in Southern California almost his entire life. He was born in San Diego in 1960. Went to Occidental College, and would eventually make his amazing career right here on Channel 5.
Reporting from the Oscars, I'm Sam Rubin.
Sam Rubin became Channel 5. In many ways, the heart and soul of KTLA, a more than three-decade-long run.
Not to take myself here, does anybody remember when you used to dress up to go on the plane? Oh, it was like a big deal.
This was his last show appearance this week, and in typical Sam fashion, he cracked jokes and flashed smiles. Many will remember him as a news icon, but to those who truly knew his talent, the bigger-than-life personality, Sam Rubin represented so much more. He lived life to the fullest, owning every moment, the highs and lows, while bringing others along for the ride.
In the newsroom, I'm Sam Rubin.
Well, a lot of us had the honor of working with Sam for so many years. There were so many people that he helped and mentored. You worked closely, Doug, with him quite a bit.
First off, how are you guys doing right now?
It's tough.
Yeah.
Tough,
you know, it's like, I don't think I've processed it yet.
Yeah.
You know, it's like I started off my morning, I heard the news, and it was almost disbelief. And then as you get in here and you start seeing all the tributes and you start seeing Sam and you realize he's not here, it hits you differently. I feel like I'm processing it on the air right now as we speak.
Yeah.
But yeah, you talk about somebody on the carpet. I mean, I got a firsthand look at how dynamic he was, and it was just awe-inspiring. I mean, the fact of the matter was that we do this for a living and we speak, and sometimes there's not a prompter, and he was more comfortable when there wasn't a prompter than when there was.
Yeah.
And there could be any situation on a red carpet and he could talk his way out of it. And and for someone like me, especially when I first got here, I would look at him and go, wow, like I don't think I'll ever get to that point.
Well, it came so natural for him. He had that encyclopedic mind about Hollywood, and he could just react to things when they came by. He just somehow knew which direction to move to, or what was going to be comfortable for the person that was in front of him.
You know, what's funny is a lot of times when you see our red carpet specials, and we did several of them every year, we would always have a pre-show, and we'd have a sound check the day before. Yeah. And every time we did a run-through, whatever came out of Sam's mouth, it was never the same thing. It was always different every single time. I mean, that man was never short of words.
Watching these clips is almost therapeutic, I think, for a lot of people. I mean, without getting too maudlin about it all, being in the newsroom, it's just so heavy. When you come out here and watch these clips, I think it helps.
And I also think being around you guys helps too. You know, you could be alone and you try to process it, but you don't quite know. But when you're here under this roof, I mean, this building is Camp, is yeah. Sam. I mean, you know, there's a large portion of Los Angeles who only know Sam as their entertainment reporter for 40 years.
Doug, I just have to say, it's absolutely. So hard for you. Obviously, you and Sam work closely in the entertainment department, but you literally had to go sit at his desk today and be down there with the same people who work on putting obituaries together for the celebrities. They're still grinding today, doing this for Sam. And I imagine Sam's flattered by that, but also not surprised that they would work just as hard.
I'll tell you what Sam's flattered by. I share a desk with Sam, and Ryan Seacrest alluded to this earlier, talking about how messy his Volvo was. Anybody who knows Sam knows how messy his areas were. And Sam and I share a desk. And for years, this desk just piled on clutter and clutter and clutter. Just this week, it was cleaned.
Really?
Yeah, this week it was cleaned for the first time. So it's like, I walk into this desk and I'm like, wait, Sam's not here.
But organized chaos.
Organized, yeah.
You know, Frank Buckley mentioned earlier, because his car apparently was a mess as well, but he said Sam knew where everything was, and he could go to that pile of trash, or what we thought was trash, and just grab what he needed.
Sam was organized chaos at its every bit. And by the way, thank you for letting me sit in on this today. I just, you know, I'm kind of one of the, it's funny, when I came in the morning news, there were all the OGs, and then after, really, I was a part of it for about 15 years, I'm kind of like a junior OG, I guess, and I just, the DNA of the KTLA morning news, at the heart and soul of it, is Sam. And, you know, we talk about it coming in waves. It all seemed very surreal, as I think it probably does for many of the people watching at home. And then I got into the newsroom, and we all are very much on work mode. I think we all are professionals. We're trying to get the job done and trying to eulogize a man who, quite honestly, was the one that eulogized everyone else.
Yes.
I mean, Sam was sort of a master at that. And I shared this story earlier, and I think it bears repeating, that if you follow Sam on his social media, he would always take a really strong moment, and he would do it on the air as well. When someone in Hollywood of any sort of importance passed away, he would eulogize them. And even if it was an A-list star or someone who was, you know, a star from a 70s sitcom. And I once asked him, I said, Sam, why do you spend all that time, you know, doing that? That's a task upon all the other tasks. And he says, because when people pass, especially in this town, people stop. And I think of all the people that are stopping today because of the news of Sam. Yeah. And it is, we're all processing it. But thank you for letting me be here to share a little.
Well, he affected so many people.
Yeah.
I mean, so many lives over the years.
By the way, I just did an interview with Kevin Frazier from Entertainment Tonight, who shared some great stories about the red carpet and what a master he was at just pulling out the thoughtful questions. But Kevin said, and I think we'll share this later in some of our reports, he said, you know, one thing that Sam would really like today, he's the number one trending topic on all social media platforms in the United States of America. So to know Sam is to love him, and to know that he was always, he loved KTLA, but he was always looking for the next gig. He was always looking for Dancing with the Stars or hosting Entertainment Tonight. And he was shameless at talking
about
that.
And he felt that he could do anything.
Absolutely.
Hosting American Idol, as we just heard.
It's funny because, like, we talk about it and we mention it in such egotistical terms, but he was so deprecating while he was, you know, it's like
It was so obvious and overt.
Right.
Funny.
You expected it and you knew, like, come on, it's a joke.
But that was kind of the fabric of that KTLA Morning News show, which so many other shows tried to recreate or have that kind of chemistry, and that was Sam, and you too, Wendy. I mean, just
Sam was the essence of it. I mean, Sam was the one that sort of, you know, in the early days, and we've shared this story, gave license to kind of like going with a moment, having fun, and doing all the skits. And Sam knew a good moment when it hit. And, you know, talk about, we've been talking about this again, and it bears repeating, and I know some people are just tuning in right now and kind of catching up with from the news of the day, but Sam was the biggest supporter
of every single person here in this newsroom. It didn't matter if you were on your first day or if you had just had a bad day or if you'd gotten in trouble with the boss, because he did have some experience in getting in trouble with the bosses.
Several times.
So you did get in trouble. You're like, oh, look, there it is. My last picture with Sam, and I'm dressed as a hot dog.
And that's appropriate.
And this was just on Friday, right? Last Friday?
Yeah, so we both come. This was for our book, Summer Movie Preview, which Sam really, it was a brainchild of his to preview all these summer movies, and it's a terrific part of our morning show. And I got a text from his producer to say, you know, will you be a hot dog? And I said, yes, Sam, I will be your hot dog. And then we both laughed, because when I would walk by people in the hot dog costume, they would just say, hey, Wendy. Like, no one would even act like that was something unusual. And that's because Sam Rubin made it okay to dress as a hot dog on morning TV. Yep.
Well, if you guys can sit here at the desk with us, we want to bring somebody. And you know, Sam spent his entire career here, I think, at KTLA 5. And he was admired not only by the people here, but the people that worked at other TV stations around town. Fritz Coleman was a staple in this town over on NBC, doing the weather there for years. Fritz, it's great to have you calling in. Your memories, your thoughts on Sam's passing?
Hey, Frederick, and I my heart is torn out of my chest watching you from the moment this was a news story with Frank this morning and his team, and listening to you now. This is an awful day and an historic day in Southern California, because I think that Sam was one of the last of the real Hollywood correspondents, one of those guys whose whole mission was to do the ebb and flow of what was hot and what was not in Hollywood. Nobody did it better. His personality was created for the kind of presentation he did, and he was unbelievable and lovely and joyful. And in my minor way, I got to know him, and I benefited from his fanship. I'll tell you, I was on the KTLA Morning News about a month ago, and I just talked about my comedy special. And after that little five-minute segment happened, I sold out three shows in a row just from his announcement. And honestly, that was the first time I understood the power of what he means to the entertainment community in Southern California. So I just want to say I'm so very sorry for you. And my heart bleeds for Channel 5 and all of his fans throughout Southern California. It's the passing of a truly legendary figure.
Yeah, Fritzy, he had an impact on so many people over the years. We appreciate you calling in and sharing your memories of Sam and everybody here, the family at KTLA.
Hey, Fritz, one quick question, too. Didn't you love how Sam, I think, really was the first one in the market to actually talk about the news happening at the other station?
Oh, yeah. No, that was cool.
And, what did your management think about that?
Even if it wasn't a totally positive
experience. Exactly.
But I will tell you, and I just found this out today as we were researching Sam, his first television appearance was on our station.
Really?
When Telly Lang was doing a five-part series on tabloid journalism. And Sam used to write for National Enquirer. Yeah. And they had him on at the 11 o'clock news on Monday, and he was so well received and so full of life, they had him back every single night through the five-day series till Friday. And I hear tell that that was his launch sort of into Channel 5 and your newscast. There may be some slight alterations in that story, but I'm not surprised.
And we go from that to him being known worldwide, basically, at this point, with his connections over in Europe and down under in Australia. We've been hearing people calling in from overseas. Everybody.
You know, until I heard that, Rick, I didn't even know he was doing the morning news in England. What time was
that? There's a lot you don't know about Sam Rubin.
I don't think most people knew that.
If I may, because I spent a better part of my afternoon trying to get out to Australia and talk to some of the folks that knew him, talk to Rich. And by the way, we need to work on getting an international calling line out of the newsroom, because
we'll talk to Erica
about management that. But we finally figured it out. And what happened, so many of you don't know, but Sam did a daily, almost daily call-in to News 9, to their, like, Good Morning America, like, kind of like our show, but it goes throughout the country in Australia. And he was their Hollywood connection. Mm-hmm. And so he is known as a television personality in Australia as well, so much so that if you went to News 9's website today, he is their top story. Mm-hmm. They did a three-minute segment on him. Yeah. And the person, Rich, who we spoke to, did a call in with us, but also said that he broke down on the air in Australia in speaking about his friend Sam.
And I think he's having that impact on so many people today. Fritz, when you were on the show there, you could just tell that Sam knew so many people and so many celebrities, but it never really went to his head. I think he realized the impact he was having on so much of the audience, but you didn't get that when you talked to him one-on-one.
No, he had the perfect personality for the job he did, because sometimes it was the only positive news in the newscast or in the entertainment news. That and maybe a morning clouds and fog, hazy afternoon sun with a marine wave.
It just comes back to you.
But he would be, and he was always so enthusiastic to bring it to you.
Yeah.
And he was the same way when you'd see him at the Golden Mics or the Emmy Awards. He was a bigger-than-life personality. And I think that was 50% of his draw. He just could not wait to tell you what the latest show business news was, and it was infectious.
Yeah, Fritz, I think you hit on something, and Doug, you've had to do the same thing. The news is so dark most of the time, and then suddenly you have to walk into the studio and shine this light and be the energy. And it's got to be tough, day after day after day.
Luckily, I learned from the master. I mean, that guy walked in and lit up the room. Yeah. And, you know, there's a couple things that I really admired about Sam, but one of them also, when I first got in here, and, you know, it's intimidating when you're talking to celebrities, and Sam did it for a living. It was like, it was old hat to him. But one of the things that Sam did that separated him from everybody, and I don't even know if most people even recognized it, but it was a little subtle nuance of his approach, was he was the only one who could walk into that room and talk about, like, interview somebody for a film and never even mention the film.
Mm-hmm.
And,
yeah.
And you talk about these moments that he took over and enhanced, but he created a lot of those moments because of that. He had a different approach. Whatever was coming out of that celebrity's mouth was not something that they had regurgitated 12 times to other journalists.
Just, his questions were so thoughtful and so smart that it got smart, thoughtful answers in response. Mm-hmm. You know, instead of just the typical, oh, what was it like working on the set? How are your co-stars? He really had these just, he could have done a master class on how to interview. And
he would have loved
celebrities.
To have done it.
Just that somebody asked him. You know,
I think that it's a passing of a type of journalism. And what I mean is, we're now in the era where people come to work and they're general assignment reporters, like you'll go out and do a freeway chase one day and then you'll do a celebrity tidbit the next day. And the specialists in a particular area are sort of a bygone era. But he was the last of the real Hollywood media titans where that was his expertise. People came to him and he went to them. And it was, I think it's a passing of a different time. I really do.
Yeah, we just showed a picture of Sam in his underwear standing on the news desk.
The moment you said media titans. So that was a moment right
there.
There
you go.
But that was something about Sam. He would rub shoulders with these huge names out of Hollywood. And then the next moment he would be acting like a goof and just doing something. I mean, he just ran the whole gamut of emotions.
The stars had such a familiarity and a trust. And I think it is very hard in this town to develop a trustful relationship with celebrities. Just there's layers to get to them. And then when you get to them, but Sam somehow cracked the code.
I've been doing it for 12 years and, you know, people still come up to me and say, "How's Sam?" You know, I mean,
or do they say, "You're not Sam"?
I'm going to bow out here, guys.
Oh, Fritz, thanks, Fritz.
I want to tell you, your reflections are very, very lovely. And I've been watching you all day long, and your connection to this man and explaining how his family extended far beyond the walls of your television station, not of the public, has really been something to watch. And my thoughts are with you. I send a lot of love to the Channel 5 group, and thank you for inviting me on for my comments.
Fritz, we feel the love. We appreciate you calling in.
Fritz, Sam loved you.
Okay, guys.